Hey guys, so today we're going to talk about how to keep programmers motivated, basically. So let's get into it. Now, this was yet another great subscriber question, and it's something that is it's kind of interesting because it's a very tricky subject. Like, how do you keep somebody motivated? How do you keep a group of people motivated? But I think I can give you some input on this, as I've been working in a few different teams now of where you've had varying considerations. So the first and foremost thing that is fairly important when it comes to keeping people motivated is to, you basically have to have the right group. Now, what I mean by that? Well, the thing is, guys, in my experience, you have to fundamentally ask the question, is your company the sort of company that has the potential to keep people there for reasons apart from the two normal things? Because in general, and this is not just for software development, in general, people stay at the job for two reasons. They are being paid well enough. In other words, there's a convenience factor, like there's a pragmatic, practical reason for them to be there. And the second thing is they enjoy the company, like their coworkers are nice people. This is not motivation. This is just kind of just to set the baseline for usually why people stay at a job. So convenience and like just basic work or work related benefits. So the first and foremost thing you kind of have to think about here is that certain companies have, you know, they will, if you don't even have this, if your employees are unhappy with their working environment, in other words, you're not paying them enough or you're overworking them or whatever, and you have a bunch of people who are maybe not, they're not so social, they don't really have a good connection to each other. I mean, this work office environment, like this thing, it's very much depends on culture. I mean, I've been in other countries where I'll give you a great example. Here in Sweden, it's standard practice, basically. It's almost like the norm that all the coworkers, like at lunch, we all go out and eat together, or we sit together and we eat and we socialize and all that stuff. In the UK, I actually, when I was there, it was hilarious. I went into the main office of my old job and I just asked everybody, hey, what's lunch? Hey, you want to go out to lunch? And everybody looked at me like I was a freak or something. What do you mean? You want to go out for lunch? Okay. And then I kind of, after that, we just went out and everybody was like kind of weirded out by it, but they did enjoy it, it seems. But then I was told that, yeah, no, this is not common practice here. People don't do that. Now, you don't, of course, have to do this sort of thing, but you kind of have to just bear with me here. So having this like relationship with people that like, where you actually enjoy talking to each other. I mean, if you're all in a cubicle and I mean, if you don't even know your coworker's last name or, you know, something of that nature, then it's very tricky for you to build up this environment. So that's the first step. You need to have an environment where people want to interact with other people, and you need to have people who are interested in actually contributing to the project in a, how do I put it, going a little bit above and beyond. Because if they are only there to cash out a paycheck and they're not really motivated as people, because there are people like that, guys. There are people who don't, like, they do this 9 to 5. They are not there to necessarily be enthusiastic about what they do. They're just there to do a job. And it's very hard for you to get them excited about something, even if you try. So that's the first thing you need. The correct environment, the correct office culture around collaboration and innovation and all that stuff to start off with. And you need to have the sort of people who are actually interested in programming, who are actually, who get motivated by their work. If you don't have that, nothing else will matter. After that, you have to ask yourself, all right, once again, are we the sort of company that can accommodate is it desirable for us? Because large, like a small company and a large company can have certain limitations on what you can actually do. Let's say that you are a small company and you have these very hard, like maybe you're very close to the edge. Your margins are very, very tight and money is tight, and it's very tricky for you to kind of cultivate a environment where people feel motivated by, say, innovation, but you may be able to take the approach that, all right, you know, you can give incentive for good performances and stuff of that nature. You can build a family type of vibe around your company where, and this comes back again to people, where people are motivated. Okay, you're all aware of that you're working for a small company and your margins aren't all that great. But to leverage that in, to make that a beneficial thing, to make it a thing where you gather people who really want to push and really want to like prove that they can run a successful business. So that's one way you can do it. But then you of course have, say, really, really large companies where you have an application that has been working for fairly the same way for years and years and years and years, and the management structure at your company is designed in such a way that, you know, the technical people, they really don't have a say in matters. It doesn't matter if you want to refactor things, doesn't matter how complicated or ugly the code is. Nobody above you is ever going to give you the green light to do a refactor. That is something that kills motivation very, very quickly. And if you have that sort of situation, then there's a more fundamental problem that you have to solve, which is, like, unless you solve that, which it basically comes down to management structure, you have to overhaul the structure of the company in order to even get those sorts of ideas in the door. And this is one of the main reasons why I argue that any successful IT company needs to have at the top, and this has to be a democracy basically, the managers at the top need to represent each of the departments in an equal capacity. In other words, usually what happens is that businesses have one group that is more powerful than another group. So you will see it all the time. You see certain companies are very dominated by the marketing department. Some are IT, like engineering departments, and you have design departments and so forth. If you look at the differences between, say, Microsoft and Apple, you will see, like, you can start to kind of get a feel for which departments run that company in general. And it's very important that you have a representative that can actually push these sorts of things. Trust me, I've been in companies where this has been the case, where when you didn't have a representative that had an equal say at the top of the chain, it didn't matter what you wanted because you're never going to get it, because there's always someone from another department that needs the capacity or the budget. So in order, if you have these sorts of problems, it's very, very unlikely that you're going to be able to go with the innovation part. And that's interesting because one of the easiest ways for you to hire good people and keep engineers motivated is to give them a sense of ownership. In other words, you have a project where it's their project, like they get to set their own, like you have the work that you want available to them, and they get to prioritize and like kind of say, all right, this is how we want to solve it, and we want to use this technology or that technology, and like it's quote unquote their code. That is, in my experience, the easiest way for you to get people motivated. They need to feel a sensation of ownership. Without that sensation, they will not care. You cannot motivate people who, like, this is an especially big problem in really large companies where the code base is, you know, it's absolutely massive. It's so big that people, like, no one person understands it, and it's been around for quite a while. And you're basically just in a maintenance type of situation as a developer. It's very, very tricky to get yourself to get people motivated there, and that's why I wanted you to kind of think about that first, because if you are in that situation, it's very tricky for you to keep people motivated. You're probably going to have quite a lot of people coming and going over time. It's hard to make people faithful unless, as I said, you go with the family type of strategy where you try to make people more focused about the team, to kind of accept that, all right, the code is the problem, but as a team, we can solve it. It's hard to make them motivated in regards to the code in that scenario, but it is possible. So that is first and foremost the things that you need to consider before you like even try to push for, you know, motivating people. But the thing that, as I said, that stands out the most, the thing that is most important is, if you can, is to give them this sensation of ownership. And the easiest way that I know how to do that is to basically have the approach that the team owns the code and they are responsible for their own backlog and all that good stuff, in cooperation with the rest of the company or their project manager. But the most dangerous thing you can do is to systematically shut down all their ideas. Now, because the thing is, guys, as a manager or as somebody who is managing an IT company, if you give your, if your team does, if they feel that they have no freedom, they have no time to refactor the code or anything like that, if you don't give them any breathing room, you will not be able to motivate them. Because in order for a software developer to feel happy about the work environment when it comes to software, in relation to software development, you have to allow them, because you need to know this thing about us, and it's something that happens for almost every single developer. We work with the code every day, so if the code is ugly and we never get any time to fix things that we see as problem areas, if our voices are never heard, it doesn't matter what you try. Like, it doesn't matter if you have a once a year company picnic or whatever. Nobody cares about that stuff. It's what happens every day that makes the difference, the small things every day. So if there are bugs and your developers say that, hey, we would really want to fix this stuff, then you really have to listen. That's number one. You have to listen to the developers, because unless you hear them and you allow them to make certain decisions on behalf of the project, they will not get that sensation of ownership. Because if they're only maintaining the code, if that's all they do, they will never feel that they own it. So that's the biggest tip I can give you. You have to listen to the developers, and you have to allow them a little bit of time to actually make the changes that they see beneficial. Now, don't give them everything, because some developers will, you know, they will go, and they if you give them the finger, they were gonna take the whole arm. But it's a try to have a dialogue about these sorts of things. So, to summarize, number one, first and foremost, you have to ask if you are the sort of company that can actually motivate people, that has the potential to do that. If you are a super large corporation where the project that your developers are working on is just, it's a maintenance type of thing. It's not, you don't have the sort of organization that can actually accommodate this sort of developer focus, then this is going to be very tricky for you. So that's number one. Number two is that you have to have the people, you have to have the correct people, the people who are interested in having this office culture, that are interested in going the extra mile for the project. And number three, you have to listen to the ideas of your developers. There has to be a dialogue. You cannot fill up the whole backlog with stuff that your customer wants and never listen to your developers. They have to be allowed time and ideally choices on behalf of the project, because without those choices, it's just the sensation for the developer is simply going to be that you are maintaining somebody else's product. You don't own it, because you are never allowed to make any decisions on behalf of or meaningful decisions on behalf of the project. I mean, if you don't even get time to refactor the thing, why the hell should you care? So hopefully you take these things with you. Have a great day.